good morning, everyone. This morning I was just counting that we have only 3 days left. So it's just something that goes very quickly. And hopefully you enjoyed yesterday's program as well. How was it?
Perfect.
And it's really a pleasure for me to introduce Professor E Molloy. He's been a fantastic person because he is a edge-cutting scientist, and also he is participating at our meeting of school for a long time, and his return means that even in London is Szeged counted, and I guess that his talk is very, very recent, because last year a Nobel Prize was given for his optical tweezers, for Szeged. Maybe he was the oldest man who got the Nobel Prize ever, and I guess that this institution here in Szeged also has some fingerprints on optical tweezers and manipulation with laser light and solid crystal material. But I guess Professor Molloy will show us some biology today, and it's your turn. Thanks again.
Oh, well, thank you so much. Thank you for the invitation. Yeah, and of course, I mean, Szeged is very well known to me because not only because of the laser facility that's just recently, you know, opened here 10 years ago. When did the laser, the Eli?
About 2.5 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Actually, it is not almost in the full speed, but yeah. I can say it is now in the 70% of the facility, which is working as planned.
Yeah, which is fantastic. So it'll be a center for laser science in Europe. And when I was doing my PhD, I was working on muscle. And of course, all the papers that I was reading came out, you know, from this place, from Albert St. Georgi and Straub, and all of the early biochemistry done on muscle really was pioneered. So I'm going to tell you about the use of optical tweezers, which I'm sure you've all heard about, and particularly actually the use of optical tweezers to study the mechanical properties of muscle proteins, how muscle proteins work. So the plan for the talk is the following. So what I'm hoping to do is tell you about sort of the motivation for making high resolution mechanical experiments on biological molecules, what we call sort of single molecule studies. And I'll explain how optical tweezers work. And go into some of the technical details of how you build up the tweezers and change them from being just a simple way to manipulate things into a device where you can make high-resolution measurements. And in order to make those measurements, you have to understand the mechanical properties of optical tweezers and the energy change that occurs in biological reactions, because it's essential to be able to measure forces that are in the piconewton range, that's 10 to the minus 12 newtons, and movements that are of the same order of size as a protein molecule, of nanometers, angstroms to nanometers in scale. And the energy changes that we're going to be talking about, essentially the energy is the force times distance. So if you imagine 1 piconewton times 1 nanometer, that's 10 times 10 to the minus 21 joules. That's in the same order of magnitude as thermal energy, KT. In fact, it's about 10 times thermal energy. So the motor proteins, I'm going to talk really almost exclusively about myosin, which is the muscle motor protein, as a model system for studying single molecules. And at the very end, I'll just introduce the idea of using total internal reflection fluorescence microscopy, which is easily compatible with optical tweezers, because it's another laser-based optical method, and it's just a matter of shining another laser beam into your microscope. So why would we want to work with individual molecules? And The motivation for doing single molecule experiments is that you can get unequivocal information about how enzymes work, because if you can study it, study a single molecule on its own, you can watch it proceeding through its own biochemical pathway, and you can get new insights into the enzyme mechanism. So if you're able to watch the protein go through step by step, sequential steps that make up a biochemical pathway, and observe those directly, you can watch the molecule literally as it walks through a biochemical pathway. And you can follow that both in time, which would be similar to a normal biochemical experiment, where you just follow some change in fluorescence or whatever signal you're measuring in time, but you can also follow it in space. So if you're able to visualize molecules on the microscope, you might therefore be able to see them actually moving around. So the idea of watching a chemical reaction both in time and space is the unusual thing about single molecule experiments. The other nice thing is that you don't have to synchronize the population molecules in order to study the kinetics. Normally when you do a biochemical experiment and you want to study a biochemical pathway, you'll synchronize the molecules in some way, start them in a particular state, and then you might add another chemical and then watch a relaxation as that chemical is then broken down in time and follow that exponential time course. But we don't need to do that with a single molecule experiment, because if you can watch it on its own, you can simply watch it walking through the pathway step by step. And I'll explain all these ideas in a minute when we come to a specific example. And then once you have your single molecule data set, you can treat it in a variety of different ways, and you can look specifically for heterogeneity between molecules. So if you suspect that your solution of molecules, rather than all behaving in a completely homogeneous manner, which is what you would normally expect for a chemical process, it might be that some molecules, let's say, are going faster than other ones, because they might have a different, slightly different structure or a slightly different metastable state. And in particular for muscle proteins, it's interesting because muscle proteins can be under different amounts of force. So some myosin molecules might be experiencing a big force, other myosin molecules might experience a smaller force, and that might affect their chemical kinetics. Okay, so if we're going to do a single molecule experiment, we need to think about the energy levels that are involved. And so the energy levels in biological systems are sort of listed here. So these are kind of useful numbers to keep in your mind. So a photon of light, the energy associated with one photon of green light is 400 piconewton nanometers. So I'm using mechanical units. Remember, that's 10 to the minus 21 joules. So you've got 400 times 10 to the minus 21 joules, which is about 100 times thermal energy. The energy of one ATP molecule, and you remember ATP is the sort of cash currency for energy in the cell. So nearly all energy exchange going on in your cells is mediated by the hydrolysis of ATP to ADP and phosphate. And when ATP is hydrolyzed, it releases about 100 piconewton nanometers, 10 to the minus 20, that's 10 to the minus 21 joules. So that's about, as you can see here, about 25 times thermal energy. Not that much more than thermal energy. And when an ion moves across the membrane, so let's say a hydrogen ion going across the membrane, or a potassium ion or sodium ion going across that electrical gradient across the membrane, that's about 10 piconewton nanometers, only about twice thermal energy. Okay, so and then the other final number that you keep in mind is thermal energy, KDT, which is 4 piconewton nanometers. So if you have those numbers in mind, that's sort of useful for single molecule work.
Can I ask a question?
Sure, of course, yeah. So this would be for a single charge. So the charge associated with a singularly charged ion moving across that potential gradient, that would be that's essentially the energy change. So it's QV, which is the charge and the potential difference. But that's right. But it depends on the charge on the ion and the potential gradient across the membrane. So I just took typical values for a unitary charge and then 60 millivolts, which is the potential gradient. So having got those numbers in mind, Let's now think about some single molecule experiments. So the very first single molecule experiment to be done, really, in biology was patch clamp. Patch clamp is the method used to measure flow of ions through ion channels. And this was first done in the early, mid-1977, around about then, when Sacklin and Nayer were able to measure the unitary ion current from a single channel. And this was the big breakthrough there was to have a glass pipette where they took up a very small amount of membrane from a, in fact it was from a Lewis site, which had just a single ion channel in it. And when the channel opened and closed, that would let the ions flow through the channel, and they could measure that flow of current using a high input impedance transistor and a very sensitive amplifier. And each time the ion channel opens to release the ions across the membrane, about 5,000 ions flow through the channel. So they flood through in just a few milliseconds, those ions rush through the channel. And so now we can see the kind of energy that they were measuring, because we know, remember, it was about 10 piconewton nanometers for each ion. So if you multiply 10 by 5,000, you get about 50,000 piconewton nanometers, about 12,000 times thermal energy. So you can imagine that's given that you can have transistors which have noise levels at almost down to the thermal limit, they have about sort of 5,000 to 1 noise ratio. So although very challenging, they still have quite a good signal-to-noise level above thermal noise. In order to look at a single fluorescent molecule, so this would be called single fluorophore imaging, and a lot of people are doing single fluorophore imaging at the moment to do super-resolution microscopy. So let's think about how much energy is involved in detecting single photons being emitted from a fluorophore. Well, when you illuminate something like a green fluorescent protein or rhodamine or one of these, or a dye in a stained biological specimen, they will emit about 10,000 photons per second. And you can image those quite easily using modern cameras because remember the energy associated with a photon is 400 piconewton nanometers, so the total energy here is about 250,000 times thermal energy for each video frame. Now, this isn't quite fair because the noise on a camera, the photon noise, is actually not thermal noise, it's actually due to the arrival of the photon. So the noise level is not thermal noise, strictly speaking, it's actually photon noise limited. So it's actually the statistics of the arrival of the photons, which limits their signal. But still, there's a lot of energy associated with a fluorescence microscopy. So now if we come to the making a single molecule mechanical experiment. So if you want to measure the mechanical properties of a single molecule, we now have a more significant challenge because molecular motors consume one ATP molecule for each movement that they produce. So this could be either a kinesin or a myosin, a dynein, F1 ATP synthase, any of these molecular motors or DNA processing enzymes. The energy that they consume for each step that they take is 1 ATP. About half of that is transduced into mechanical work. So you have about 50 piconewton nanometers for each mechanical event. And you'll notice this is only now about 10 times thermal energy. Rather than 250,000 times or 12,000 times, we're now only 10 times. And so thermal noise becomes a significant problem when you want to measure mechanical signals from individual molecules. So how do we go about measuring these very small amounts of energy? And we have to come up now with three different techniques. So optical tweezers, which I'm going to talk about, magnetic tweezers, which again is another mechanical technique, and atomic force microscopy. I'm not sure if anyone's spoken about either of these other two techniques, Peter, is that?
No.
Okay, so these two other techniques, which I won't talk about today, are the other two main techniques for making mechanical measurements. But I think when I tell you about optical tweezers, once you understand those, then you'll sort of understand how these techniques work. So, optical tweezers, how do they work, and what do they do? So, optical forces essentially are due to the change in momentum of light. So when light is incident on an object and is either reflected or absorbed or scattered, then you change the momentum of the incoming photon. And the change in momentum is given by E mc squared. Oh. Now, I can write that up there. I couldn't derive that from first principles, but I'll take it as being right. Okay. So if we assume that E equals mc squared and that's correct, then it's really a very simple rearrangement of that equation, which will tell us the change in momentum of a photon when it's incident on an object. Because the momentum of a photon is mc, the mass times the velocity, and that then, so just rearranging here, is the energy divided by the speed of light. And now if we want to measure the force is the change of momentum. So it's a rate of change of momentum, so it's mc divided by time. And if we divide energy by time, so E per unit time is power, so that's, we go from joules to watts. So the force produced by a laser beam is essentially the power of the laser divided by the speed of light. Which is pretty simple. And so what's that saying? Well, when light is incident on a surface, so let's say this laser, which is about 3 milliwatts in power, when I shine that at the screen, it's pushing the screen backwards with a force due to that change in momentum of those photons. And so we can just calculate that very easily. So if we take a 3 milliwatt laser, for instance, so 3 × 10⁻³ divided by the speed of light, which is 3 × 10⁸. So if someone can calculate that and tell me what it is. So 3 × 10⁻³ divided by 3 × 10⁸. Can anyone give me a number? Okay, so 1 × 10⁻¹. Oh, that's not bad, is it? Because that's now 1 × 10⁻¹, that's in newtons. So petanewton is −12. So we've got how many petanewtons?
10.
So we've got 10 petanewtons. That's not bad. So 10 petanewtons. So this laser beam is pushing the screen back with a force of 10 piconewtons. It doesn't move because 10 piconewtons is not very much force. Okay. And in fact, when you go out in sunlight and all of the sun shining down on your body is being absorbed, it pushes you backwards with a force of about slightly less than 1 milligram of force. So it's like a fruit fly landing on you. Okay. So it's, these forces are very, very small. But 10 piconewtons, remember those forces I was talking about, we're in the right range. So this is what Ashkin realized, that actually 10 piconewtons is kind of, at the molecular scale, is enough to start to manipulate things and move things around. And so the trick then is to actually harness that force, because just shining a laser at a screen, first of all, we just wouldn't be able to measure the force because it is so small. And secondly, so what's it doing? Because it's not really of any use to us. So we have to be able to harness that force. And that was really where Ashkin came in with his experiments. In fact, it was already known that this optical forces that had been known for 100 years before Ashkin started his experiments. What his real contribution to the field was thinking how you can harness that force on a microscopic scale and use it as a technique to actually pick things up and move things around. And so he, it was really the advent of laser beams that led you to do this. So that's why I'm here, I guess, because this is lasers in medicine and life sciences. So the beautiful thing about a laser beam is the fact that it's very parallel. So as I shine this beam across the room, forms a little spot over there, and the spread in the beam is actually simply limited by diffraction. So if you go further and further away, it will spread out a little bit, but simply because of the interference of the light with itself, it will spread gradually over a very long distance. But it is essentially as parallel as you can get it. And that means that if you have a very parallel beam, just by taking a simple optical element, a spherical lens for instance, you can focus it down to a diffraction-limited spot. So that's the key term. So it's the idea that you can take that very parallel light and then focus it down to a very sharp focus, a pinpoint, which is only, it's a diffraction limit. So for a laser beam of, let's say, 600 nanometers, it will focus down to about 300 nanometers. That's the smallest that you can squeeze the light through a little spot. So we can take our laser beam. Oh, sorry, the other property of the laser beam is that it has a Gaussian intensity profile. So it's brighter in the middle than at the edges. And it's Gaussian because it's diffraction limited. In fact, the image that you see when you cast the laser beam across the room is simply the diffraction pattern of the laser. So it just spreads out and it forms a Gaussian shape, which is an airy disk function. And that Gaussian just gets broader and broader with distance. But it always has this this sort of profile, bright in the middle and less bright at the edges. Now that has a nice property to it, because if you have a spherical particle, so this could be, say, a glass bead or a bacterium, anything which is roughly spherical, you can see that if it's sitting, so now this would be the intensity profile across the beam. I want you to imagine that the beam is being shone down from the top down towards the bottom. The centre of the beam is much brighter than the edge, so this ray of light here is more intense than this ray. And now if you follow the light path, as this light enters the object here, it's refracted, so it's bent towards the normal, and then as it comes away, it's bent away from the normal. So this object is optically more dense than the surrounding medium. So this could be glass in water, or glass in air, or it could be a droplet of water in air, for instance. And so this would be the light path that you take. And you can see that the momentum of the photon has changed, because the photon would have like to continue in a straight line, but it's being pushed off to one side, and the effect of being pushed off this way is to produce a reaction force in this direction. So the object itself is now being pulled this way, and if you imagine the same properties that occur on the left hand side of the beam, but because it's less intense, the force is smaller, so you have an imbalance in force and the object is pulled towards the centre of the beam. So in this simple configuration of just shining a laser beam at a spherical object, the object will be pulled into the centre of the beam, and you'll notice that these vectors are also pointing downward slightly, so that will also be pushed forward. So as you would expect, the object would come into the beam and then would be projected forward. So if I shone this laser beam across the room, small particles of dust would probably enter the beam, and if I held it here long enough, would travel in the middle of the beam and then pile up and form a little pile of dust particles on the wall across the room. We know that won't happen because they'll get pushed out by Brownian motion. Okay, so that's the thing that's competing. With these confining forces, the competing forces will actually have gravity and Brownian motion. So let's just see now where that stage is. And that is to try and observe the forces. And so the first system that Ashkin devised was this system which is the first thing you're told to do when you're using lasers is never look into the beam. Okay, so he fearlessly stared right into the laser beam, but he had a filter here to filter out the laser light. But in this experiment, he had glass particles which entered the cuvette, and they all tended to precipitate slowly. And as they moved through the volume of the cuvette, they would enter this laser beam. And indeed, they'd be captured and then pushed up against this wall, and then you'd see particles which then got stuck onto the wall of the cuvette. So you did see this kind of pile-up effect. So that's great. That's a nice demonstration of the optical forces. But it was less useful because he wasn't able to actually move things around. So the next version that he came up with was to have two counter-propagating beams. So a laser beam that comes in here, a laser beam that comes on this side, and then now looking from the side of the object, he was still able to see it through a microscope lens. And because the laser beam, remember they're spreading out over distance because of the diffraction effect, so they actually naturally just get slightly wider here. And so you can imagine now this laser is pushing the particle in this direction, this is pushing in that direction, so you have a stable equilibrium in the middle. So now you actually form a three-dimensional track. So if it moves down, it gets pushed back up because of the gradient force of the light, and if it moves to the left, it gets pushed more at the right, and so on. So now it sits in three-dimensional space, and if you move the laser beams around, now you have the magical property of actually being able to manipulate the particle in three dimensions. So now you have an optical trap. And it's this sort of configuration that's used by the physics community. So this, in fact, Steve Chu got Nobel Prize for essentially for his work with optical tweezers, looking at supercooling, what's called optical molasses, where you actually, rather than using two beams, you put about six or eight beams of light into a supercooled mass of atoms, and then you can then reduce their effective temperature down very, very close to absolute zero. So these sort of multi-beam traps are used, as I say, by physicists. But biologists are much more enchanted by this method, which is really very, very neat, because then he discovered this what's called single-beam gradient trap, and this is the breakthrough for the biological community, where you take a laser beam and you now use a high numerical aperture objective lens. So this is what biologists use all the time, of course. Physicists never use these lenses. But biologists, well, they do a little bit. But this is the absolute tool that all biologists use, which is the very high numerical aperture objective lens, which usually is an oil immersion lens. So are you familiar with that? Yeah. So this would be a lens that would probably be 100 times magnification. And then, I haven't shown it here, but would have an oil immersion glass cover slip and then water the other side. But just for the sake of the schematic, I've removed those elements. But it means that you can have light now entering an object with a very high input angle. So that's the key thing so the numerical aperture is just telling you about the angle of the light that you can shine onto the specimen. And you can produce an incident angle here of about 60 degrees, that kind of angle. And that means now that when the light hits the particle, rather than these vectors always pointing away from, in other words, in the direction of propagation of light, these angles now actually angle back towards the incoming laser beam. Okay, so it's in a way it's slightly counterintuitive, but the particle is actually drawn into the region of light of highest intensity, and it sits, in fact, in a stable equilibrium just below the focus of this diffraction limited spot. So if you have a particle, this is a grossly exaggerated particle size. This particle would maybe be 1 micrometer across, and this spot size here would also be about 1 micrometer in diameter. And the particle then sits just below the focus of the laser light. And the competing forces that you need to think of here are what are called the gradient forces, which are due to these changes in angle of the light as it enters the particle and leaves the particle. And the scattering forces, which are due to light scattered off the front face of the bead and also off this face here. And those scattering forces indeed do push the bead out of the... So the scattering forces always act in the direction of propagation of light, but the gradient forces act backwards towards the focus. So now we have a single beam gradient trap, which means that we can pick up a particle and move it around in a light microscope with just a very simple alignment, just putting one laser beam into the objective lens. And in fact, in order to realize optical tweezers, all you need is your standard microscope objective lens and two additional lenses outside the microscope. So, and that's it. So, in fact, when I first made one of these things, it was sort of astonishing. You just take a laser beam. In fact, I just had to put one lens outside the microscope, because there happened to be another lens of just the right focal length inside the thing. And you just put one lens in there, shine a laser beam in, and then suddenly you're capturing little particles in the field of view. It's absolutely mind-boggling. But you know, that's the genius of invention, really. This guy, you'd think, well, it's so simple, why didn't anybody do it? But of course, that's the genius of the thing. So optically, you're probably familiar with these ideas of conjugate planes. I think some come up. So with an optical system, you have what are called conjugate planes, which are essentially this plane here in the optical system is conjugate, sort of identical in space, as it were, with this plane over here. This is at a focus, and if this focal spot moves up and down here, this focal spot will move up and down here. And this is another conjugate set of conjugate planes here. And if the angle of this light changes due to moving this mirror, the angle of this light here will move in exactly the same way. So essentially what this is showing is that if you have a mirror at this position and you tilt it backwards and forwards, it'll change the angle of the light here, which will translate this spot up and down here, which will move this spot translationally on the XY plane. So that's the key aspect of this system. Okay, so that beam, that mirror then enables us now, just by tilting that mirror up and down or left and right, we can move the optical track in the XY plane, and it moves perfectly in plane with the microscope. Now, in fact, when we want to make high resolution measurements, we replace that mirror with an optical element that enables us to make those movements at very, very high speed. So the ability to move a mechanical mirror is limited by the resonance of the optical component. You can imagine if you're moving a big piece of glass around, there's a limit to how fast you can move it. So we and other people use another element, another thing called an acousto-optic deflector. And this optical element is used now in many applications, or particularly in confocal microscopy, but any kind of laser scanning microscopies, these things are often used. And I think you have heard about these before. You've had in previous years. Have you been told about AODs, acousto-optic deflectors, or acousto-optic modulators? I'll just explain them very briefly, because they are important devices for laser science, really, because they're useful for deflecting, for moving beams, the angle of a beam, but you can also select different wavelengths. So if you put in white light here, this is, if there's a diffraction pattern here, then you can select different wavelengths. So I'll just explain how it works very briefly. So you have a crystal of material. Physically, it's about the size of a sugar lump, about 1 centimeter cubed. And it's a pure crystal lattice, usually of something like tellurium oxide or some sort of rare earth material, but it can be just made out of quartz, out of silicon oxide. And on that little cube of material, on this face, they stick a piezoelectric manipulator, a little piezoelectric device, which when you apply a high voltage to it, will change its size. And you can do that extremely rapidly, and up to the megahertz range. And that's because this is a very lightweight, solid-state device. It means it has a very high resonance frequency, in the sort of gigahertz. So we can use, a 50 megahertz oscillation on this piezoelectric element. That produces a travelling acoustic wave through the material, which means that you have a difference in refractive index, which is modulated as a perfect sinusoidal pattern, and it travels through the material and then is damped on the other side by this element over here. So, and hopefully doesn't get reflected back again. That's actually technically the problem with the thing. So by changing the frequency of this oscillation, we can change the spacing of the acoustic wave. So high frequency makes a very narrow spacing, low frequency makes a wider spacing. And if we use 50 megahertz and we know the velocity, the acoustic velocity of the material here, we can produce a spacing of, let's say, 15 microns, something like that. So if we shine in laser light of about 1 micrometer in wavelength, that's the commonly used wavelength for optical tweezers, it will produce a deflection of this grating here of about 75 milliradians. So here's another thing. Why do we use milliradians as a unit? That's confusing. Why don't you use degrees? Milliradians are actually a very nice unit for, again, for optical physics, because a milliradian is a millimeter over 1 meter. So if you have an optical path distance of 1 meter, 1 milliradian is 1 millimeter of movement over here. And so 75 milliradians is 75 millimeters. That's a movement of about that much. So, and we can change this modulation frequency by about plus or minus 10%, something like that. We can go from 55 megahertz down to 45 megahertz. And in that frequency range, everything remains nice and linear, as we can say, which means that you have an operating movement of about 15 milliradians, 15 millimeters. Now we have to think of the optical circuit that I told you about a minute ago. We have about a 1,000 fold magnification in the optical system, well, 100 times objective and then 10 times magnification from the other two lenses involved. And that means that 15 millimeters goes down to about 15 micrometers. And that's great for doing optical experiments because you're very close, well, within a order of magnitude, you're close to being able to scan across the whole field of view in your 100 times image of the specimen. So when you look down the microscope, this device, by simply turning a knob to change the frequency, you can move your spot of light with perfect linearity across the whole field of view. So everything just happens to work nicely. So that's why these things have been adopted very widely for these optical scanning applications. So it gets a bit more complicated when you want to build a mechanical sensing device out of this system, but essentially it just depends on what the lab is doing as to what optical components you will combine in this system. But it will consist of a laser used for tracking, something like an acousto-optic deflector or some sort of scanning device, the objective lens which is being used to image the object, and then maybe other fluorescence imaging systems or whatever. But the other key thing is to have a detector system which enables you to measure the position of the beam. So we'll come to that in the next slide. So first of all, this is just a demonstration of the optical tweezers. So here they are in action. So this is just a normal microscope. The laser is out here. These are just the optical elements to make the light path. And then, as I say, just you can imagine, because it's just an electrical input to that acousto-optic deflector, you can write a computer program to do whatever you like. You can make completely abstract patterns. And in fact, the way that we're able to trap four objects here at the same time is by making use of the fact that you can move the spot of light very, very rapidly. So we move it. In fact, there's only a single spot of laser light here, but it's moving from here to here to here to here, and going round and round and round, servicing each one of those spots very, very quickly. So it's like juggling plates on the end of a stick. You've got to go home and juggle this plate and then juggle that one and get back. So long as you get back before the particle is diffused out of the trap, you can get back and pull it back into position, and you just do that extremely rapidly. So this is called time sharing or multiplexing. And then you can pick things up. So these are just one micron particles diffusing, so you can see Brownian motion. And these are obviously in the optical traps. So in order to measure forces and movements using this rather than just a party trick to say, oh, I can pick things up and move things around, big deal. Now how are we going to use that to measure the force that's produced by a single biological molecule? Well, we need to have a detector system, and that's done using very often a four-quadrant photodiode. So you'll have four photodiodes at the image plane. You'll take your dark object, which is the optically trapped particle, project it into the center of that four photodiodes, and when it's perfectly centered, the output's zero. But as it moves very, very slightly off to one side, you get a response curve that looks something like this, which has a linear region in the middle. And over that range, you can measure deflections which are in the nanometer range. So this is actually, I don't know if you can see this, but it says this is minus 200 nanometers, that's plus 200 nanometers. So you get a kind of linear response. This would be the voltage output from our detector. Over a limited range, you have a linear detector. So now that means that we can measure displacements of the particle in the nanometer regime. So now if we want to do what you might call super resolution imaging or super resolution mechanics, I just want to talk about those two concepts because they're the same kind of idea. And you've certainly heard about super resolution imaging, I think, over this week, where you can localize a single fluorophore with extremely high precision. So that is a sort of a statistical problem. And we've got the same statistical problem doing super resolution mechanics. So if you want to do super resolution optical imaging, you need to know statistical analysis of the spatial distribution of photons from a point source of light. So you have your single fluorophore, it emits light, produces a diffraction limited spot, and you try to measure the exact centroid of that spot. And you can do that, essentially, as long as you can characterize the autocorrelation function, the area disk function of that spot, you can measure the centroid with a precision that's limited simply by the number of photons you collect. So if you collect 10,000 photons, your ability to measure the centroid is the square root of 10,000, 1/100th of the spot size, which is 300 nanometers. So 1/100th of 300 is 3 nanometers. So if you can collect 10,000 photons, you can measure the center of mass of a single fluorophore with about 3 nanometer precision. And that's done by imaging the thing onto a camera and fitting an area disk function. If you want to do super resolution mechanics, we again have to use statistical methods, because we now need to know about the temporal distribution of forces and movements from a thermal limited noise. So thermal noise is you can think of that in the same way as you think about diffraction. So in the way that diffraction spreads out photons over a certain area, let's say about 300 nanometers in the light microscope, thermal noise will mean that the particle that you hold in the optical trap, rather than being perfectly fixed in space, is diffusing slightly. So it's actually not, its center position is never actually held, its average center position is held accurately, but at any given time, its position is randomized by thermal noise. So just to sort of say that